A far musical cry from Porgy and Bess, but nonetheless a marvelous new recording by Grace Bumbry. Suicidio from Ponchielli's La Gioconda with Stefan Saltisch conducting the Stuttgart Radio Symphony. Grace, of course, opens at the Met this Wednesday as Bess, opposite Simon Estes' Porgy. And it was during a rehearsal break at the Metropolitan last week that I was able to snatch a few moments with both of these splendid performers. And I began by just checking out. I thought, but I wasn't sure, that Grace Bumbry had never performed Porgy and Bess until now.
No, this is my very first experience with Porgy and Bess. And I went through a complete change with Porgy and Bess, because originally I really didn't like the piece at all. And when I started learning the music, and as of October up to now, I've fallen in love with it. I'm a complete turnaround. I think it's one of the most beautiful scores I've ever had the pleasure of singing or taking part of, and I'm looking forward to these performances very, very much, extremely much.
Does singing an extended role of this sort in English make a difference for you? Do you have to concentrate more on the dramatic values, the text, anything else because it is English?
Not any more so than I would in any other opera. No, I don't think that changes at all. And I don't think the vocal production changes at all either. It's just that it's a completely different way of acting, I think, than I'm accustomed to. It's a new style for me. It's a new venture into a different area that I never touched before. Uh-huh. It's much more active. It's much more, well, it's American, isn't it, first of all? And it's very popular. It's what I would call American verismo.
very good term. Simon Estes, did you need convincing to really get into the score here?
Well, not really, in that I've sung it before. My first time I'd ever sung the role straight through was with Jimmy Levine in concert version in Cincinnati in the festival, I think it was 74, 75. And then I did a production of it in Zurich in 77, which we did about 30 performances. I always liked the music of Gershwin, and I've always felt that it was an opera and that it was not a musical. And I'm thrilled that the Metropolitan Opera is bringing it here and treating it as a grand opera. And I'm very happy that Jimmy Levine had the foresight to stick to his original thoughts, and he decided it really should be performed at the Met. And he fought for it, and he was able to bring it here. And I think it's great that there are so many great voices that are going to be debuting on the Met stage.
You know, there are moments that I hear what I would call a musical in the score, but I think that's typical America, you see. And as this is also written by an American composer, I think he was absolutely within his rights, and it was understandable that he would put in also that area of music. It goes without saying, the first act sounds very much like Strauss and any other grand opera you want to put your finger on, but there's also that lighter vein which comes in. But as I said, why not? It's America. It's Americana.
Simon, I was just about to ask you what differentiation you see or feel in musical comedy versus opera, given that you're talking about the same score. Is this production, because it is at the Met, because it is opera, very different from the ones that we have seen in revival on Broadway and elsewhere?
I think probably the ways in which it's different is, number one, there are no microphones that we're going to be using. They are treating it in terms of the staging, the directing, as an opera. They're not treating the singers also as, I think, there's a little difference. I mean, I've really never done a musical before, but from what I've heard from other people, artists are treated a little differently. And here I think it's being treated as Verdi or as Wagner. And so I can't really compare it to a musical because I've never taken place in a musical before. But I've never ever thought that Porgy and Bess was a musical. I've always felt it was an opera.
Well, I come from a completely different point of view because I never sang it before where Simon did, you see. And I have seen it, and I've only seen it as a musical. So coming from that point of view learning it then as an opera was a bit disconcerting at first.
Grace, I still want to pin you down. when you say learning it as an opera or learning it as a musical, you've got the same score, the same notes. How would you learn it differently if it were being done at the Belasco Theater?
Well, I think it's also the mentality you take with you when you start studying it. I mean, if you open up a score, if I open up Carmen, it's a different feeling than if I open up Carmen Jones. You see what I'm saying?
Yeah.
And I think that's what made the difference. I went to that piece of music, this piece of music of Porgy and Bess, with the idea and the fact in mind that I was going to perform it as an opera, and there was nothing that I was not going to do that is not operatic. You understand what I mean?
Yes. Yes.
Now, if I were to sing Carmen Jones, of course, I would sing it with a different weight of voice than I would sing Carmen. Now, if we were singing Porgy and Bessie Jones, that may be a different story altogether also. I don't know. I would imagine so.
Simon, when you take a piece such as I've Got Plenty of Nothing, which is, as Grace said before, if not a popular song, but in the popular idiom, it's very Americana-ish. It's very, it's close to a spiritual in a sense. Again, do you treat it any differently than you would a Verdi aria?
No, I don't. I treat it exactly the same. The only difference is perhaps the interpretation because of what Porgy is actually singing about in that particular aria, and that's the first time that Porgy has thought about Bess, and that's why he's happy, and that's why the people come out at one point and they say, look, Porgy has really changed since Bess has come to live with him. And so in a way, I'm thinking about it as my first real happy moment of my life. And so I sing it the same way I would sing another aria.
Mm.
I really don't treat it any differently because it really is an opera.
Oh, I got plenty of nothing, and nothing's plenty for me. I got no car, got no mule, got no misery. The folks with plenty of plenty got a lock on the door. Afraid somebody's going to rob them while he's out of making more. What for? I got to lock on the door, that's the way to be. They can steal a rug from the floor. That's okay with me, cause the things that I prize like the stars of the skies on a I got plenty of nothing, and nothing's plenty for me. I got my gal, got my son, got heaven the whole day long. No use complaining, I got my gal, got my lord, got my son. I got plenty of nothing, and love is plenty for me. I got the sun, got the moon, got the deep blue sea. The folks with plenty of plenty got to pray all the day. Seems with plenty you sure got to worry how to keep the devil away. Hell till the time arrives. Never worry long as I'm well. Never want to strive to be good, to be bad. What the hell is bad as a boy? I got plenty of nothing, and nothing's plenty for me. I got my gal, got my son, got heaven, got all day long. No use complaining, I got my gal.
I've Got Plenty of Nothing, Simon Estes, the Metropolitan Opera's first Porgy. And he was singing on this brand new recording with the Berlin Radio Symphony under Leonard Slatkin. Also with us on the Great Artist Series today, Grace Bumbry, the first Metropolitan Bess. And now I have a question which has intrigued me for quite a while. There was a distinguished black artist and unfortunately, I cannot recall who it was. Don Shirley, perhaps? I'm not positive. An instrumentalist who says he adores the music of Porgy and Bess, but he cannot abide seeing a staged version because of the stereotypes, because of the revival meetings, because of all of the elements that black artists have fought to put into the background. How do you feel about doing Porgy and Bess as a current piece in 1985?
I think that it should be performed in a way more or less the way Gershwin wanted it. If you want to take an opera out of its context in terms of a certain period of time in history, that means then perhaps we shouldn't do Don Codlo the way that it should have been done many years ago or any other opera. We have to look at operas in a way, they're almost all myths. You know, there's a lot that you can play with. It's not really reality. And in terms of the stereotyping, I don't feel myself personally threatened by it at all, because Gershwin wrote the opera in 1935 or whenever it was with a certain thought in mind, and he was trying to create a certain mood, and he captured considerably well the black atmosphere at that time of the people, how they actually lived on Catfish Row, the certain ways in which they spoke. And what we're doing is bringing an opera that was written 50 years ago, and we're bringing it in here today, and we're performing it again as an opera. Because I think if you want to say, oh, well, people might be offended about something, then I think you could find in a lot of operas that people could be offended, whether it be Wagner. You could, in that case, say there's some German people could be very unhappy that they're performing Wagner.
Well, there's even some Shakespeare that might be offensive to Jews.
Yeah. Huh?
Yeah. But I tend to think, intended to have thought, let's put it that way, like this person you were mentioning before, because that was really my reason for having been so reluctant in accepting the role of Bess. It took me about 4 months to accept it. But after I did accept, and I think the reason why I accepted was because I began to analyze the whole situation. And I said, well, the Metropolitan certainly didn't ask me if they could do Porgy and Bess as an opera. They're going to do it with or without me. And I thought that if I wanted to be presented in a very good light, then I want to be part of it. And I have to be part of it. Otherwise I would be complaining constantly, all right? So then I decided, how do I get past all of that stereotyping? Well, you can't get past it. It's a part of American history. And whether one admits it or not, whether one is ashamed of it or not, it still is there. And I feel that it has to be done, and has to be done well as an opera. And I want to be part of that.
Wonderful. Wonderful. I am gratified at this, because this is an area that I am frequently worried about when I find a piece of music that has some sort of a derogatory phrase or term. And it can be Mark Twain. I mean, to read some of Huckleberry Finn is to cringe a little bit at the language, and yet we know where Mark Twain stood.
Sure.
But it's very difficult to know how this will play in a modern sense.
Yeah, it's a piece of history. And we have to see it as such. And not only history, it's also not only American history, but it's also our racial history in America. And it reflects both whites and blacks, you know, onto both races. It's part of America.
Living's just begun. to over yonder looking lady hungry. Don't you let that person keep you hanging round my door. Ain't you heard the news this morning? Step up, brother. Buzzard on the way. Old age, what is you anyhow? Nothing but being lonely. Pack your things and fly from here. Carry grief and pain. There's two folks living in this shelter. Eater, sleeper, singer, praying. Ain't no such thing as loneliness. And Porgy's young again.
Another sampling from this marvelous, brand-new recording of the Gershwins' Porgy and Bess, Simon Estes and the Buzzard Song. We have this disc from Phillips, by the way, on a test pressing, so the album not quite ready for distribution, but coming up very shortly. And coming up very shortly, the continuation of our conversations in music with Simon Estes and Grace Bumbry, the Porgy and Bess at the Met. So stand by, and we'll continue in just a few moments. Our guest today in the Great Artist Series, Grace Bumbry and Simon Estes. They will be singing in Porgy and Bess. And the opening night, just a few days away, Wednesday. And let's see, Grace Bumbry, you do the first eight performances. Mm-hmm. And Simon, you have a dozen or so.
Yes, I do 12 out of the 16, yes.
So what's happening? You're going on to other things?
Back to Europe, yes. I'm picking up Carmen now after 15 years of not having done her. And I'm looking forward to that very much. And then from there I go, I think I have two months off. Mm-hmm. And then I have some concerts with Shirley Verrett in the summer, June, July, so July, August. And then I have some Aidas in Verona. And then September, I think I'm back in America. I don't remember everything.
Well, I hope you get a chance to rest once in a while.
May, didn't I say May, June? April or May or something like that, I forget now.
And in and amongst all of these other activities, you folks have been making recordings. And Grace Bumbry, why don't we dip into your opera album? Now, this was made with the Stuttgart Radio Orchestra, so I assume it was made in Stuttgart. Is that a wise decision?
Pretty good decision.
And what differences do you find in the recording process? Now, this is an aria album. It takes in a whole lot of different styles, different periods, and so forth. Do you approach the learning of a piece for a recording any differently than you would to learn it for concert performance or, beyond that, an operatic performance?
Well, to be absolutely truthful, I think I learn it just for the recording. I have to study, of course, what goes on up to that point where the aria comes in, to find out what the story is all about and what the aria is about, and so that to give the right pathos to the aria. But most of the things that are on there, I think most of them I've sung already in its entirety. I've done Gioconda, I've done Forza del Destino, I've done Trovatore, Lo Cid. Please, if I'm not mistaken, because Sappho, nobody sings Sappho.
Nobody sings Lucide either, but except you.
That's true. And the Sappho aria I've done so many times, I think you pretty much know it. And Divinite Justix, I had never done that on stage, but I was in preparation for a production at that time. So just about everything.
All right, well, let's choose Louise, since you said that's one of the missing links, right?
Fine.
Depuis le jour, from Charpentier's Louise. Grace Bumbry on this new recording. Stefan Soltes conducting the Stuttgart Radio Symphony. And Simon Estes, your recording, in addition to Porgy and Bess, of course, your new album is of Wagner arias. Now, here it would seem to be a great relief not to have to worry about singing over the top of these 100 players that are fortissiming. So is a recording easier in that sense?
I think the recording is easier simply because I'm able to concentrate on the music and I don't have to worry so much about the stage directing. And you don't have to worry as much, of course, about maybe fighting an orchestra if you're not well situated on the stage. So I enjoyed it tremendously simply because it was just music that I was making.
Do you find that, Grace, also, that there's a certain benefit to the recording studio in the sense that you can be freed from the other worries that go into an operatic performance?
Yes, I think so. Pretty much so. In some respects. And on the other hand, maybe not. Because when you have the other set and scenes and all that stuff going on around you, sometimes it's easier to sing.
I think it was Jim McCracken that said on this program, one of the great problems with recording is that it becomes so well balanced that everybody then comes to the house the next time and they expect to hear it exactly in the same sense of focus.
So in one respect, we do ourselves an injustice, don't we?
That's right. But just think how nice it is for us listening. We get the excitement all and we get the perfection on the disc. And your conductor was whom here?
Mr. Frick. He's an East German conductor on the Wagner album.
And if we were to wait for the rest of Wotan's farewell, not to mention the magic fire music, we'd be past news time, I guess. So we will call a halt. We've heard part, at least, of Wotan's farewell in this stunning new compact disc, marvelously sung by Simon Estes, with Heinz Fricke conducting the Berlin Staatskapelle Ensemble. It is, of course, with Simon Estes and Grace Bumbry, the Met's Porgy and Bess, that our conversations are continuing today, and we will get back to them, and indeed get back to Gershwin, after these further announcements. Simon Estes and Grace Bumbry visiting with us in the Great Artist Series. Again, we look forward to the performances of Porgy and Bess at the Met, in which they are featured. The opening night, Wednesday evening, and then the first 8 of the performances upcoming with Grace Bumbry, and thereafter, who is taking over your place? Who's your next
best? Robert Mosley will be doing the Porgies that I'm not doing, and Roberta Alexander will be doing the Besses that Grace will not be doing.
She's on the recording with you, yes?
Yes. Uh-huh. Yes.
So that should be very nice. I don't know her work at all. As yet.
I had not worked with her before that, and we just only did the recording just this past September, October. Mm-hmm. And she's not sung the role before either.
So we have a lot of freshness and discovery going on here. Tell us about the extra link in this chain. We've talked about the music, we've talked about the drama and the recording elements, but I'm very curious about the conductor. I've had many conversations with instrumentalists, particularly pianists and violinists, and terms of what they are looking for from their conductor. From you, as singers, what do you want the maestro to be? Do you want him to follow you? Do you want him to lead you? Do you want him to be a partner? Do you want him to be a boss?
In a recording or on the stage?
What, it makes a difference?
Well, I think it does.
Well, then either or.
I think that I would like to have a conductor who, first of all, knows the repertoire. And if you're doing a recital record, you're doing more than one composer, usually. And I think it's rather important that the conductor knows the different styles of the different periods. And if he doesn't know them, then he should bloody well study them, just as we had to study them.
Isn't it more or less of a given that any sort of halfway reputable conductor knows different styles?
Well, you would think so, but from my experience, that has not always been the case.
Mm-hmm. No. Simon, what about you and your experience?
I like a conductor to be more than just one particular facet, and I think the good ones really are. Number one, conducting means that you're supposedly leading, so they are supposed to be a leader, but I think a conductor also has to be an individual who is flexible and who does accompany, yes, because after all, if you are singing an aria or a quartet or whatever, they should accompany us. I think a conductor should be someone who is sensitive. I like to work with conductors who come up to us as singers and ask us if we are comfortable. I think it's very important that a conductor realize that we also have ideas. I'm not saying that they are always correct, but I think it's wonderful if a conductor is an individual with whom we can exchange our ideas and our thoughts. And then I think you have a beautiful ensemble. So I look forward to working with those conductors who are more or less after this mold.
Well, certainly. I agree with you 100% there, but you don't always get them. And it's not a given that the conductor always knows what he's doing. I mean, there are some conductors who have wonderful, wonderful, important names, but it's one thing to be able to conduct an orchestra very, very well, and it's another thing to know what singing is about. And it's not every conductor who knows that. I mean, it's all fine.
What we need today, too, are conductors who are sympathetic and understanding of the human voice. We often worry about singers getting into vocal problems today, and that does happen, but I think it's many times conductors in their enthusiasm, they get carried away too much with the orchestra, and the orchestra is really too loud. And when a person comes to an opera, they really want to hear not only the voices, but they want to hear the text. And I don't think it's only because sometimes people's voices are not big enough. I think it's because perhaps there's not enough sympathy given to the singers. Because years ago, you know, the voice was very, very important. And
years ago.
And today, sometimes, I'm not saying obviously with all conductors, but there are some conductors that are really not as sensitive, I feel, as they should be to the singers. And if a person comes to the operas, I say, they really want to hear the voice. If you want to hear pure symphony, then obviously you can go to the symphony hall and you can hear a symphony orchestra in which the conductor can pull out all the stops. And I think it should be that way. There are times in an opera also when all the stops can be pulled out. I mean, if it's in the overture or something else. But I think we need to have conductors who understand that we have these two little teeny strings in our throats. And it's not like a violin string. If one of them gets broken, you cannot buy a new one and put in.
That's right.
But fortunately, there are, I think, more conductors who are becoming aware of that again.
Simon, a point that I raised earlier, just touched on with Grace, and I think you just touched on it, that not only do we want to hear the music, we want to hear the text.
Mm-hmm.
Sometimes we can get away with not hearing the text if we don't understand it.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, if you're singing Italian, and I don't know Italian, as long as I get the idea, I'm not too upset.
Mm-hmm.
Whereas if it's English, we do want to hear the words, and we're expecting to hear the words.
Right.
Does this put, and this brings us, of course, back to Porgy and Bess, does this put additional pressure on you to get those words out?
Well, I really tried to get them out in any language in which I'm singing, I must say. But
I think you're right.
You come back to English in that we are here at the Metropolitan Opera, or in America, let's say, and we are singing English. It makes us probably a little more aware of singing the English text clear than perhaps if we were singing it in Germany or in Italy. So there is a little bit of added pressure, obviously. It's the same way I think when one is singing in Italy or in Germany, that you are very, very conscious of the language and you work very hard. And I think we as Americans do the same thing when we're singing English in this.
But that's a very interesting point. And especially in this case, where you're also singing dialect. So how much emphasis do you really put on the text? Do you dot the I's? Do you cross the T? Or do you not? Do you slur it over as you would if you were sitting right next to another person speaking in a dialect? Mm. Like, for instance, the other day, I think Simon was saying fretting. You know, I mean, one gets accustomed to rolling the R's. All right, so would you say fretting? Would you say gimme? Or would you say, give me? I mean, in the text, it says, sometimes it says, give me. Sometimes it says by somebody else, give me. So what do you take as the measuring rod?
I think in the case with when you're doing an opera like Porgy and Bess, where you do have dialect, within the black community at that time, there were individuals undoubtedly who spoke clearer and more distinct than others. And there were some of the people who had a little better degree of education than others. I think probably what Gershwin has tried to do is mix this up. And there could be times even when there was an individual who perhaps was not educated, and he might say, give me, instead of gimme. I think, and that, because there are certain times when, in the role of Porgy, when a word, okay, the fretting that Grace talked about, this was really funny, that just slipped out, you know, and I was happy that they brought it to my attention, so I say fretting, but it slipped out. But there are times when, even within my text, when I will use a word maybe like told with the D, and another time I say toll. And Gershwin wrote it that way.
You know, like today, for instance, Philip corrected me by saying that I'm putting too many endings onto my words, like coming or playing or something like that. And I didn't realize that I was doing it, because I thought for sure that I had been singing it as the text had been written. But you get so accustomed to having heard those duets and arias, and sometimes you sing them in normal English, you see. But my point was, how far do you go? How far do you go in trying to make the text as clear as possible? Do you dot the I and cross the T? You know what I mean?
I think what we should try to do, at least what I try to do, if I'm going to say a certain word with a dialect, I'm going to make sure that if I'm going to use a dialect, it's a word that I know that people are going to understand. Now, most people understand if I say chillin, they know I'm talking about children. Now, there's sometimes I might say children, other times I might say chillin', but it depends upon where it is. But I think what is important is that the people understand as many of the words as possible, even if we have to cheat a little bit and maybe not sing it exactly the way they did at that particular time in the South. Because even today, it has changed somewhat.
God help me to find her. I'm on my way.
And we have returned yet again to the new album of Gershwin's Porgy and Bess. And we should include DuBois Hayward in that list of credits, obviously. Simon Estes with Leonard Slatkin conducting the Berlin Radio Symphony. We have been talking today with Simon and with Grace Bumbry. We look ahead to Wednesday night, the opening night of Porgy and Bess at the Metropolitan, and then quite a number of performances thereafter. And I'm most grateful to you for breaking up, or using up, I should say, your rehearsal break here to speak with me. I'm dying to see the show already, and I'm sure it's going to be just great. What other adventures lie in store? Grace gave us some idea of her future. Simon, what are you up to these next...
Well, I'm in the midst of my Porgy and Besses, I will be doing Grayman here at the Metropolitan Opera, and also I'm Fortas and Parsifal. Then in April, I'm off to Florence to do Filippo and Don Carlo with Zubin Mehta.
Is Florence back in that?
I think she is, yes, Florence Quivar. And then I come back in May, and Leontine Price and I are doing a concert the 31st of May in Carnegie Hall to raise money for the people in Ethiopia and Africa who are starving and homeless. Then I go back to Bayreuth for a long summer again, and recording The Dutchman also.
Are there any other roles of this sort that would intrigue you? Any other parts that you're waiting to do and just sort of tapping your feet till somebody asks you for?
Well, I'm going to do my first Macbeth, the title role of Macbeth in Zurich, and I'm going to open the season in September, and I'm moving into some of the Verdi baritone repertoire, and I'm looking forward to doing some of these Verdi baritone roles. Okay. All I can say about Grace, now, if I have problems with my Verdi roles, we have to also get after Grace, because she came and told me she thought I could do some of those, so I'm going to take her advice. Thank you.
Well, no. Thank you both for a fascinating hour.
Oh, it's been my pleasure.
Thank you.